Good morning. Today we are into the 11th lecture on this course Applied Electromagnetics. We will learn and develop conceptual understanding of divergence theorem. We have already learned what is divergence. Divergence physically means spreading of a physical quantity, the extent of spread of a physical quantity from a point. Okay, so we have a reference point. How much this function spreads as I move away from the point, that is the divergence. Okay, so mathematically the physical quantity can be expressed in terms of a vector function, and therefore we can use the del operator, which we already learned, and operate on this vector function in a scalar product manner. We will be able to get the extent of spread of this vector function. Okay, so we have already seen this. So here is the vector function, capital V equal to Vx I hat plus Vy j hat plus Vz k hat, where Vx, Vy, Vc are the components along X, Y, Z direction respectively, and I am going to get this del dot V. So we know what is del, okay? And the way I have written del, I have explained the unit vector has to come prior to the partial derivatives along the three directions, okay? So there is a reason, because I got is a unit vector, it is constant. You take it with dou by dou x, it will become 0 if I were to write I hat over here. Same is the case with j hat and k hat. Therefore, you have to prefix the unit vector direction whenever you write the del operator. That is the correct way of writing del operator. And so this dot product fashion, which means the resultant quantity will be a scalar quantity, and we already know this. So del dot V will be equal to del dot V will be dou Vx by dou x plus dou Vy by dou y plus dou Vz by dou z. So that is so much for the mathematics. So what is this divergence, extent of spread? So we have seen a faucet in our homes, and a faucet, from the faucet there is a flow of fluids. At the outset, I will tell you that the divergence and curl, these terminologies were extensively used by even today by fluid mechanics people, and then other branches of field took cue from there and they started using. And this del operator is such a super simple operator algebra, and it's very, very useful, as we'll learn throughout this course. So from the faucet, we can see the fluid emerging out and spreading, and there is an extent of spread. So this can be calculated by what is known as del dot V. And a sink, on the other hand, the point where the fluid converge and go through the pipe, through the sink, that point is a point of negative divergence. Okay, it is a point of convergence. We call it as point of negative divergence. Now in electrostatics, we have a point charge, positive point charge, which is a source. Okay, so here the field lines emanate from the positive charges radially outward from the point charge. Okay, so there is a spreading of this electric field from the positive charge. So that extent of spread we can calculate the delta T. Essentially, that makes up the Gauss's law, okay, which you will see. And on the other hand, a negative charge, if you look at it, you will have the field lines converging. So it's a point of, so the field lines emanate out, okay, and spread out from a positive charge and end on a negative charge, okay. So do not attempt to think, because it is starting from a positive charge and it is ending on a negative charge, we'll think like there is a curled, okay? Well, if the charges are at rest, essentially, there won't be any curl. For electrostatic field, del cross E is zero. So we will come to timering field at a time when it is, when we are ready. The time when we have developed a complete understanding over electrostatics and magnetostatics, that is the time when we'll talk about, we'll bring the concept of Faraday's law, following which we'll take the timering fields. This is a point of negative divergence. Now, physically, if I were to look at it, when we go to a pond and stand on the edge of the pond and say we spread, okay, we spread, or we actually put a heap, okay, of sawdust at a point, and from that point we see that the sawdust is spreading, okay, which is actually controlled by the flow of fluids around the, at that point. So if the flow of the fluids is such a manner that the sawdust spreads from that point where you dropped it, then that point is referred to us as a point of positive divergence. On the other hand, if the sawdust, even if you try to sprinkle it, but the sawdust try to keep together, okay, collect together, okay, it doesn't spread out. So it's a point of negative divergence. So there is a practical example that you can see in our daily life. Divergence of typical functions, we already see this positive charge from where the field lines emanate, and it is spreading out radially, which means I can write this direction of this field in radial direction, and for that radial function I can actually take the divergence, and I will see that there is a net divergence associated for that field. Okay, so that is very clear. There is no, the only from the positive charge the field lines spread out, and as it goes far and far, the field due to this charge is going to drop by 1 by r square, as we famously know by the famous Coulomb's law, okay, that gives you the field due to a point charge. Now there is also you can see this kind of a vector function. The magnitude is uniform, the direction is uniform, which means with respect to any point, in this case it is going to be del dot v is going to be zero, because there is no spread everywhere, it is a constant vector flow, which means there is no spread on this. Now let us look at the other example, where here the field lines are going in positive z direction, but the difference between the previous one and this one is that here the field lines are actually they are of magnitude, which is like a different magnitude, but direction is the same. So which means the vector function is changing. So whenever there is a vector function changing, and you can actually hear, there is vector function is not changing, the magnitude and the direction are same. On the other hand, here you can see that the magnitude and is changing, okay, and the direction remains the same. That is the essence of this. Okay, so here definitely, if I were to compute del dot v, there will be a spread. We have seen all these examples. So let us go to divergence theorem. What does this divergence theorem say? The divergence theorem, at the outset, I would like to mention that it is also known as Gauss theorem and Green's theorem, and it relates a volume integral, which is essentially a triple integral, to a surface integral of a vector function. So this is what the relationship mathematically, del dot v d tau triple integral, which means over a volume, okay, so a volume integral of the divergence of a vector function, okay, will be equivalent to this one, vector function dotted with da, infinitesimal area vector, over a closed surface bounding the same volume, which is very, very essential. So how do I write this statement? The statement can be written in this manner: the integral, okay, of a derivative within bracket divergence over a volume is equivalent to the value of the function at the boundaries. The boundaries here refer to a closed surface for a volume. Okay, so remember this, the boundaries for a line is the point, boundaries for a volume is a closed surface, boundary for a surface is the line path. Okay, so boundary for a line is end point, boundary for a volume is a closed surface, boundary for a closed surface, let us say I have a rectangular surface like this, the surface is bounded by the lines. Okay, so this is something very useful to remember, and here you can see that mathematically, if I were to, I just told you the text, the integral of a derivative within bracket, divergence of a vector function over a volume is given by the value of the function at the boundaries. Okay, and boundaries here mean the closed surface. So the left hand side represents the total spread of the vector function from a point over the volume. The right hand side, on the other hand, represent the total flux flowing out of the closed surface. So surface, more importantly, bounding over the same volume. So we can't take some other surface and try to equate it. That is the essence of this bounding the same volume mean. Okay, now let us take this example, which we are going to also deal when we come across the, after the introduction of Coulomb's law, we are going to get into the discussion on Gauss law and the usefulness of Gauss law in electrostatics. How to, the Gauss law essentially helps us to determine the electrostatic field, okay, due to a point charge or also other charge distributions, we'll come across that. So here, from the positive charge, the field lines spread radially out, and we know from Coulomb's law that the field, electric field, electrostatic field is given by, due to this point charge capital Q, Q divided by 4 pi r square epsilon naught r square, 4 pi epsilon naught r square, where epsilon naught is the permittivity of free space in vacuum. Here I am assuming the medium to be air or vacuum, so I do not have to worry about the dielectric constant of the medium or the, and resulting in the change in the permittivity of the medium. Okay, basically the permittivity of the medium is related to permittivity of the air or vacuum by multiplying with the constant, what is known as dielectric constant. Okay, so we will come across that, but for now you can take that the electrostatic field due to a point charge is Q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught r square, pointing radially, so r hat, that is the thing. So once you have that electrostatic field, I can estimate what is delta t for this vector function by bringing in the concept of divergence as applied to a spherical coordinate system, and we will see that it is going to tend to, because if you take that over the left hand side, I have to integrate over the volume, and the volume element, I can take a very infinitesimally small volume element over this entire volume, and d tau is given by r square sin theta dr d theta d phi, which we have learnt already. So what I want you to do is, I put that infinitesimal volume element over this, integrate over that volume element, and then if I apply the limits of the spherical surface, spherical volume, okay, where the radial radius runs from 0 to capital R, and the theta runs from 0 to pi, and the azimuthal angle phi runs from 0 to 2 pi, I will be able to get that it will be equivalent to what is exemplified in this statement. So we will see that delta T d tau equal to rho d tau epsilon naught. What is this rho d tau? So rho d tau is essentially the where rho is the uniform volume charge density, which means charge per unit volume. If capital Q is spread over the entire volume, and I know the volume of this sphere to be 4 by 3 pi r cube, the capital Q divided by this 4 by 3 pi r cube will give me rho, provided it is uniformly spread out. Okay, you might have a non-uniform rho also, that will then involve not taking out of the integration, rather you have to integrate with respect to what is d tau. D tau I just told you, it is r square sin theta dr d theta d phi, and you can substitute, you will get essentially this statement, and this is the Gauss law. And if I were to write it in differential form from this, this is also integrated over the same volume, here also d tau is the same volume, so essentially delta t will be equal to rho by epsilon naught, which is the differential form of Gauss law. Okay, and on the other hand, if I were to apply the Gauss theorem over this one, I will get the closed the flux. Okay, because if I take any, it is spreading radially outward from the point, I can take a very small cross sectional area, and that area's direction of the area point along radial, which means the infinitesimal area element, if I were to substitute here for this right hand side, I will have dA will be equivalent to r square sin theta d theta d phi, and the area vector has a direction, and the direction, while the volume does not have a direction, the area vector certainly has a direction. Volume, infinitesimal volume element is a scalar quantity, whereas we have repeated that the area has a direction associated, and outward normal is the direction always associated with the infinitesimal area element. So in this case, it will be radial. So the infinitesimal area element will be r square sin theta d theta d phi. Okay, we'll exemplify again when we talk about this one and Gauss theorem at that time, Gauss law at the time of electrostatics. So do not worry about it. Just I am giving a hint where this divergence theorem will be useful, and we can get the integral form. So whether we take the divergence and integrate over volume, or whether we take the flux of the electrostatic field over the closed surface bound in the same volume, we are going to get the same value, because after all, triple integral rho d tau is nothing but the total charge enclosed in the volume, so that will be q enclosed. But one thing you must realize here, I write the subscript enclosed, which means it tells the essence of the Gauss theorem, which means the charge has to be bound by the volume to contribute to the flux. If the charge is outside of the volume, then when I integrate over this volume, I won't be able to get contribution due to that charge. Again, this point will be emphasized during the Gauss law. Now, let us try to develop this mathematical understanding of divergence theorem for the following function. Vector v equal to y square x hat plus 2xy plus z square y hat plus 2yz z hat over the unit cube shown in figure. First thing, once you see that, first thing that you must write, given vector function, I want to unit cube. So limits are given, vector function is also given. So next thing, the very first step I must write is, what is the statement of this divergence theorem? So it states that the volume integral of the divergence of a vector function is given by the value of the function at the boundary, essentially the total flux which is got by integrating this v dot dA over the closed surface bounding the same volume. So once we, so let us take the left hand side to begin with, so we can actually find out, determine what is del dot v, and then d tau for a unit cube is basically, essentially, if I take a very infinitesimally small volume element within this unit cube, then the volume element will be dx, dy, dz. All I need to do is to substitute that and get the limits of the integral correct, 0 to 1 for x, 0 to 1 for y, 0 to 1 for z. So once I do that, here is what I am going to get. So all I need to do is, given vector function, first thing I must also notice that what are the components along x, y and z direction, and I write it here. Okay, and then I substitute directly. I see that del dot v, there is vx is only y square, whereas we are going to differentiate with respect to the variable x, which means it will become 0. Then vy is actually 2xy plus z square. When I differentiate with respect to y, I am going to get 2x. Here this term will be, there is no y term in y involved, so it is essentially constant. So when I differentiate with respect to y, I am going to get 0. And as far as this is vz, 2yz, so z is here, so I am going to get 2y simply. So it is del dot v is nothing but 2 multiplied by x plus y, and I can substitute over on the right left hand side, and I am going to get essentially the over this the right hand side, which means this is essentially the total flux. Okay, so net spread over this volume of a unit cube for the given vector function, it is 2. Different vector function, you will get different result obviously, and different limits, you will get different results. So it all depends on both the vector function. After all, the vector function is the only one that represents the if I were to take electrostatics, the vector field represents essentially the electrostatic field. Okay, so now vector function is given, we'll take the right hand side. So here right hand side, it's relating to the total flux over the closed surface. So here for a unit cube, or for any cube for that matter, there are 6 faces that close this cube, right? So if I were to compute, I already told you the direction of when you compute, this direction of aerial vector will be, so correspondingly the field lines will be actually flowing out of these 6 surfaces, and the direction of the surfaces have to be taken appropriately. Okay, so that is the point. So which means I have front face, back face, right side, left side, top face, bottom face. So there are 6 faces. So for each face, I have to separately calculate the surface integral and sum it up. I'm going to get the answer for the total flux in this manner, which is written over here. Front side v dot da, back side v dot da, right side v dot da, left side v dot da, top side v dot da, bottom side v dot da. Okay, and here, so that is actually close. So do not put closed symbol over here. That means you are not getting the point. It has to be only closed surface bounding the volume. But the moment I take only this surface, it is from the charges inside. I told you already the essence of Gauss theorem. It requires the charge have to be bound by the volume. The charge must be inside for it to contribute to the flux. Okay, so any charge that is outside of this volume does not contribute to the flux that is flowing through the surface. Okay, that is the converse. So let us take one side at a time and evaluate. V dot da is there. So let us give you an example for front side, and then tabulate the values for all the other sides. You can check it at home. So v dot da is like this: 2x y square x hat plus 2xy plus z square y hat plus 2yz z hat. So for the front surface, x is constant, y is changing, z is changing. If I take an infinitesimal surface area element, it will be varying along y, it will be varying along z. So I'm going to get dy dz, and the direction is going to be towards me. This is outward normal. the charge is inside. From the charge, the field lines emerge and spread out from that positive charge. Okay, outward normal. So we have this V dot dA. Always remember this. You take outward normal as the positive direction, and in the case of divergence theorem, when you apply, you can take the direction to be along the axis. Okay, that will more or less. Of course, you have to look at the volume, and then you have to apply your mind thought process whether the charge is there and net outward flux from the charge. Front side V dot dA is there, so we have we can take that substitute. If I substitute, dA will be along x unit direction, and it will be d y dz x hat. So it will essentially mean y square dy dz when I take the scalar product. Okay, and I can get, as x is constant, I will have y equal to 0, z equal to 0, upper limit, lower limit, I apply, I will get 1 by 3. Similarly, for the back face, I'm going to get minus 1 by 3. Right side, I'm going to get 4 by 3. Left side, I'm going to get minus 1 by 3. Top side, I'm going to get 1. And the bottom side, I'm going to get 0. Okay. So if you were to write, if you attack a problem systematically, there is no way you will go wrong. You try to do quick mathematics, you might slip. Okay. So be careful when you do a problem. Try to be systematic in your approach. So once I have this, I can calculate the total flux flowing out of this surface. And essentially, the sum of all of this, plus 1 by 3, minus 1 by 3 cancels out. 4 by 3, minus 1 by 3 will give you 3 by 3, that is equivalent to 1. 1 plus 1 equal to 2. 2 plus 0 equal to 2. So we can clearly see the total flux flowing out of this unit club, unit cube for the given function over okay, that is equivalent to, which is the same as what we got in the volume integral. Here you can see, so it is the same as the volume integral. So essentially, we have proved the validity of the divergence theorem. In this case, left hand side equal to right hand side are equal. Left hand side and right hand side are equal. Okay, so that is essence of the divergence theorem. Remember, divergence theorem, if you want to take a message home, okay, this is your take home message. Yes, volume integral of the divergence of a vector function is related to the total flux flowing out of the surface bounding the same volume. Okay, so it is relating a surface integral. A volume integral relates a surface integral for a vector function through divergence. Okay. So how do I digest? I will give you one more example. You have, let us say, I have a volume, and there are several faucets. Okay, from where the liquid is flowing out, I can calculate this the total amount of fluid that is flowing out of the faucets by two ways. One is, I can take the extent of the spread of this fluid flow and integrate over the volume. On the other hand, if I go around the boundary, and the fluid will be flowing perpendicular to the or you can take the projection scalar and you will get a scalar product V dot dA, that will be the same. So I go around the boundary, take V dot dA and keep adding it, so I will get the same as summing it up over the volume of the divergence. So essentially, I have a volume, I have several faucets, each faucet is pouring certain amount of liquid, and as it flows out, it is spreading, and I can take the divergence and then integrate over an infinitesimal volume element, and then okay, first to do with, after that I keep summing it for all the faucets. So that is one way of computing what is the total total volume of the water collected. On the other hand, I can also go around this boundary, and I can take the net flux over this volume, but this closed surface is actually bounding that volume. So I can go around the boundary. So what I need to do is the vector function is like this, and the aerial vector is along this direction. I need to project the aerial vector onto the vector function, or vice versa, because scalar product is commutative, and take components, integrate over the closed surface, I will get the same. So two ways of computing the total flux. That's the essence of divergence theorem. Okay, either you can do the divergence of the vector function, integrate over the volume, or you can go around the boundary, take the flux and integrate over the boundary, which is a closed surface bounding the same volume. I repeat. Okay, thank you.